Yang tuli minyakkan aboni, yang tuli minyakkan aboni sogala, yang tuli minyakkan aboni, yang tuli minyakkan aboni sogala.
You guys to join me as women. I would love everyone to say after me.
Challenge, I choose.
Sing along, Raylon, 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 Raylon. Seems that's the way. One more time, Raylon, 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 Raylon. Seems that's the way. I want to introduce the other lady. A round of applause for Pendo on percussion. And I'm Sheila. Don't you ever despise a woman. She is smart. She is beautiful.
Mic testing 1 2 1 2 1 2. Mbona
iko sawa?
Iko sawa. 1 2 1 2 mic testing 1 2 1 2.
As women, we should be united. We all agree to that, right? The next song we're going to sing is called Stand By Me. When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see. No, I won't be afraid. No, I won't be afraid. Just as long as you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Won't you stand by me? Just as long as you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Won't you stand by me, stand by me. Whenever you're in trouble, won't you stand by me? Stand by me, stand by me.
Hi again. I need a favor. I need a favor, especially the second row. We need, if you could take some other seats, please. Because this front row is fully booked. Yeah. Musisikie vibaya. I am the bearer of very bad news. Kusongesha watu kutoka kwa viti to viti. I am sorry. Second row, please just musisikie vibaya. Sorry. Musisikie leo. Leo musisikie vibaya. Hata mimi nimeshtuka kwa mwani announce. So me, I'm the bearer of the very, very, very bad news. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. There's a reason we need that cleared because of some people we have in. Thank you so much. I appreciate. Thank you so much.
Just as long as you stand by me. So darling, darling, stand by me. Oh, stand by me. Won't you stand by me?
Kumbata is the name of a dance we do down Johannesburg way. And everybody starts to dance as soon as Pata Pata hits the stage.
I don't know she didn't need apple.
Thank you. the gentlemen in the house who are proud and brave enough to be our accomplices. Welcome and welcome to International Women's Day. Jamani karibuni sana. From Nairobi, mko wapi? Nani anaambia Nairobi ni kwenu? From Kisumu, mko wapi? From Mombasa, don't you touch me. Thank you very much as we start off. And as you come in, you know me, think about what it is you have chosen to challenge. Each one of you. What have you chosen to challenge? What have you chosen to challenge? Now, I don't want textbook answers. We're not going to do textbook. My sister, no textbook, because we want to change things. What have you chosen to challenge on this IWD? And please remember, this is an International Women's Day that is 111 years since we began. So you are here on the 111th year of IWD. What do you choose to challenge? What do you choose to challenge? What? That is textbook. You know me. That's textbook. We want specificity. I refuse textbook, Jim. Hey, that English, that one, that camera, that one. What do you choose to challenge? What are you challenging? What are we changing? 111 years later, my sister, and you have no specific thing you want to challenge, I don't allow you. How do we leave the room with you telling me a textbook thing I refuse? What do you choose to challenge today, 111 years later, since International Women's Day was set? Since 1910. Imagine 1910. Women like us have been sitting and saying, Hamisa, what is it? What do you choose to challenge? You're welcome. We're in good company with the Femi Ninja Trio. You haven't seen young people, young women leading their own band, singing it out, holding their space. Please listen. A very big clap. Shayla, Ivy, Nicole, amazing. Amazing young women. Posting us today, singing their hearts out. Welcome them as our guests walk in, and please, you can stand and dance without listening to that music. I've requested they repeat it. I love it. It went here. You know the one that goes twap? The one that goes twap and it is not caused by the other gender, you know it's even better. It goes twap. It wasn't caused by the other gender. It's caused by young women singing for women. So let's get it here. We can stand and just listen to them. Please take it away.
Yeah. Let's all sing the national anthem.
That when you want to hide, or when you want to sit down in a corner, Femnet does not allow women to hide behind under a stone. You know life, the situations of life when sometimes you want to crawl under a stone, and the stone should be on top of you so nobody sees you. Femnet decided. Femnet has refused to allow me to crawl under a stone. And so I'm greatly honored to host you today on International Women's Day. My name is Mildred Ngesa. Ngesa Nyaimbo. Jenna Nyango calls me Nyaimbo. Refuses to call me anything else. I am a great. I celebrate women with every breath I take. I understand and internalize the struggle. I know why we are as women. I know why we are. And that's why today is so important. I started off by saying it is 111 years. Since the first International Women's Day. 111. You surely must ask yourself, 111 years, and you're here. What are you challenging? What are you challenging? And I said, I don't want to hear the textbook responses. Please don't tell me I am critical, discriminate. What? What? Those who know me know I'm a communicator. So the what is important, so people understand. But what are you challenging? I want you to reflect. If it's personal, it's good. It's even good because you've reflected deeper. If it's public, it's fine. But what is it? I'm not asking for two. I'm just asking for one. So we are extremely honored to have all of you women leaders in your own rights, because you are leaders in your own rights. Look at how the Femininja trio leads with the guitar, with the drums, with the mic. They're leading. Whatever it is you're doing, whichever space you're in, you are all leaders, and so we are honored to have you. We are extremely honored to have in our midst political leaders at the forefront, and we know battles are not easy. These battles are never easy. We are extremely honored. I know that we have presiding political leaders. If you're a political leader in this group, please stand up. You do realize for women, everything is political, even this tissue paper. You do realize that point. So I expected the whole room to stand. Thank you, Dr. I actually expected the whole room. If you're not aware, for women, everything, even this yellow pen, is political. Do we understand that? Everything is political. Thank you so much, Dr. Njoroge Dorothy. I'm very honored to have you heading Association of Media Women in Kenya. That's my boss right there. So I am trying to put a good show. My boss is here, and my other bosses are here. Please allow me to welcome Daisy Amdani, Fire Fire Mama. I love that Daisy speaks with her eyes like this, with no fear or favor, and throws her points on the screen, whether you like it or not. This is the issue here. Thank you, Daisy, always supportive. We acknowledge and we really honor you. Thank you. Please allow me to welcome my boss, Foreen Foreen. My boss, Foreen. Marceline Nyambala, the executive director of the Association for Media Women in Kenya. Me, I'm a recovering journalist. So you always have to remember that. You know, recovering, unaanguka, unarudi, unaanguka, unarudi. That's my boss. So we are honored to have the power of what media ought to be like, what our visibility ought to look like when we are challenging things. Thank you so much for coming, Marceline. We appreciate you. Now also, you know, Honorable Waithera, I just told Honorable Waithera in the back room that whether she likes it or not, we as feminine women have owned her. You know the things you don't have a choice. Yes. You know the things you don't have a choice. So please, help me thank Honorable Waithera. When we were setting out Women Must Lead, she was one of the people who had to be there and listen to us, and we had said we are going to carry you like a handbag. You know there's a handbag you like? Whether you're wearing red, green, yellow, even people in the house know. So they bring for you. So we are going to carry Waithera as a handbag, whether she likes it or not. You know, we are going to give her a space to decide, but anyways, not to decide, because we've decided for her. Thank you, Honorable Waithera, and the work that you do. Ladies and gentlemen, we are here in the honor at the invitation of the African Women's Development and Communications Network, known as FEMNET. I want to assure you that across the continent, there is no regional network like that that represents and speaks for women. Now across 48 African countries. Ebu count na mkono mpaka 48. 1, 2, 3, 4. I didn't say counties, I said countries. You know, within those countries, there are counties. So across 48 African countries. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41, 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48, 49, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 45, 46, 47, 48, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 45, 46, 47, 48, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 45, 46, 47, 48, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 45, 46, 47, 48, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 45, 46, 47, 48, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 45, 46, 47, 48, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 45, 46, 47, 48, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 45, 46, 47, 48, 50, 51, 52, 53, 54, 45, 46, Who is saying no? Who is saying no? I hear somebody say 54. Africa has how many countries? Including Western Sahara. So Africa has 55. And we have somebody representing 48. How many are remaining before we take them? Mathematics? Only 7. And we are taking this year before the year ends. Allow me to just welcome our host, Memory Kachambwa. Thank you. Thank you so much. I am extremely honored to stand here and kiss the feet of my sister, Memory. It's a long story, and I have the time. It's a long story. All the way across the other side of the continent, you do realize that sisterhood has no barriers. You do realize that when women come together, we don't know language, we don't know tribe, we shouldn't actually, those things don't exist. What exists is the power of the, placenta! talk about the placenta, but I'll tell you quickly that every woman is born of and with a placenta. Am I right or wrong? And the placenta is what tribe? Is what color? Every woman is born with and of the placenta. The men are born from a placenta. The gentlemen are here. Let me quickly take them through that history so they respect the women in their lives.
Yes.
That at some point before they started the breathing, they were connected to a placenta. Now, in God's wisdom, God decided they cannot be the custodians of that placenta. So God, Eric, are you listening? Eric, thank you. So God in his wisdom decided it is the woman who will keep it. Because of the power of the placenta, for those who have used it and reused, guilty as charged, there are many of us who have used and reused the placenta, many of that's okay. And for those like Kinanyawera who are waiting to reuse, and God will bless you. And they will reuse it. And there are those who have decided they don't want to use it, it's okay. The placenta is there. So by the power of the placenta, my sister memory is joined to me. Memory, come to me. I love it when I have to torture my boss. By the power of the placenta, my sister memory is tied to me. Whether she likes it or not, is there a choice? You know, when we were singing and dancing, I realized I actually love her very much. So I paused to tell her. And the reason why I paused to tell her is because of the dedication of Femnet to Africa's women and girls. And also because, most importantly, she refuses to allow me to crawl under a stone. I said that a story, I'll say.
Yes.
Imagine I'll say, today. So she refuses to let me crawl under a stone. And so I honor her. This is Memory Kachambwa, the executive director of Femnet. If you really want to help her, come and talk to her in a lot of Kiswahili. She will be so annoyed, but then she will answer you. She will answer you. Welcome, my sister. Thank you so much. I see there is honor. Please allow me to welcome you, and I didn't take your name. And forgive me even before I say it. But you're very welcome. Can I please? Julie Murimi. Please allow me to welcome Julie Murimi. Clap for Julie Murimi. Julie Murimi. Thank you, Julie. Thank you for making it. Thank you. You see the chair was there waiting. Thank you, and you're welcome. Julie Murimi is coming in the representing the Compliance Office of Register of Political Parties. So I want to assure Honorable Hamisa Jaza and Honorable Caroline Agwanda that Juliet Murimi is an important source. You know you're going in, you're already in.
Mm-hmm.
So it's good to just pass through Juliet to get before you go to the field. Juliet and Hamisa Zad. Mume realize nime introduce my winners.
Yes.
Honorable Hamisa Jaza.
Yes.
Mombasa Konyewe Shachukua Uyobinti. If you look at Hamisa, we call her Hamisa Don't Touch. She will tell you why she's Hamisa Don't Touch. And Honorable Caroline Agwanda, you've taken it. Please greet people. Yes. Yes. Kisumu Caroline has already taken it. So without much ado, I'm being guided by KDF, one of them being Dorothy. We are supposed to start off with a very important documentary. Is that right? We play the song. Do we have a roving mic? It will help if we have a roving mic. Thank you. I love this auditorium. The social distancing is quite nice. Although I wish I could hug people. But in their wisdom, Femnet decided to give me this. It is written, I love you, but please don't hug me. Imagine, it's okay. I've been trying. Did you see me stealing hugs?
Yes.
But so the KDF are watching. I love you, but please don't hug me. Yes. So, let us take it away and just watch a brief documentary on women's political participation, a very important project that's being undertaken by Femnet with the support of International IDEA. Yes, at the front, I think you can just turn your seat at the side and just... Are we good, Dorothy?
Yeah.
Okay. sound. Sound, Doki. Are we okay? By International IDEA on women's inclusion in political participation. And because of that, I want to open the floor to the Executive Director of FEMNET, Memory, for her welcome remarks. But as Memory takes up her welcome remarks, and I know she's going to talk about why women must lead, I want her to personally tell us, personally, what does she choose to challenge on this International Women's Day? Start off by just telling us, what do you personally choose to challenge? And then tell us about this day today. Welcome, Memory. A clap for Memory.
Wow, I don't know whether Mildred, you introduced yourself. Did she introduce herself?
Oh, and me, at the end.
I don't know if you can speak now.
Yes, sweet.
Okay. I just want to recognize and just to thank our moderator, Madame Mildred Ngesa. You know, Mildred has the power, the energy, the flame. Today, I didn't want to wake up, but when she told me she'd be there, I said, who am I? If Mildred can come and say, we want to celebrate, I want to stand with everyone as we celebrate, I had to be here. So I really want to just thank Ms. Mildred for accepting the challenge. If there's anything I can just challenge, to be here, to stand up and defy all odds. You know, we have something we say, defying against all odds. And women are known to defy odds all the time. Mildred's passion is the placenta, and she will talk about the placenta. She cannot, she always talks about the placenta, somehow, somehow. And during the weekend, I was in a meeting with women from Polynesia, and they shared something about this, they called it the umbilical cord, right? I don't know whether, what's the difference between the umbilical cord and the placenta? Mildred, you tell us. But they talked about the umbilical cord, and they say when a child is born, they bury it in the ground. They bury it in the ground. And the reason they bury it in the ground is because they believe that as people, we are connected to Mother Earth. So the reason why we call Mother Earth is because we have our roots in Mother Earth. So when we are taking care of the environment, we are taking care and we are responsible of our mother, who is Mother Earth. So I found that quite interesting. And I thought this project that Mildred has been passionate about, talking about the placenta, it's just not an African, but across the continents. If you really go deep down to indigenous roots, there's something about the placenta, there's something about the umbilical cord which connects all of us. So I'm very happy today to be connected to all of you and, you know, just to stand with you in solidarity and to welcome you. But most, I'm so honored that out of everything happening on International Women's Day, you decided to honor Femme's invitation. So for me, that is so, so important. It's so dear to my heart. And I just want you to clap for yourselves for really honoring our invitation. Thank you. And to also our speakers, our Meshimiwas who are here, Keopa, we partner with them in this program on women's political participation. We've also partnered with the registrar of political parties and the women's rights organizations and the media. The media is so important to us because we know every time we talk about women's leadership, it's how women are portrayed in the media which is important. And we know that the fourth arm of the state is the media. Everything starts with the media. The media is the mouthpiece. They are the megaphone of everything around women's leadership, in fact. And we are partnering with them in this journey to make sure that we get more women nominated, more women participating and elected. And I just want to challenge you to say, how about as women, we start supporting our women candidates now, getting their agenda. I know there's a lot of politics around why should you support a woman because she's just a woman. But let me tell you, across the continent, women who take the bold step to be in politics are not just women. And they need our support. And we can propel them to push our agenda. No man is going to push our agenda. They will try and they will push it to their own advantage to get your vote and your interest as women. So that's the most political thing about having women participating in politics, is as women, we should be supporting each other, and we can support each other. And we also have to know that our decisions obviously are autonomous, but how about we start by giving financially, because the major barrier when it comes to women's participation, it is obviously the violent landscape, but it's also the money. For our political space is monetized. It is so monetized, unfortunately. And unless women have the resources, it will be difficult for them to participate. So whatever we do, let's see how do we support more women? How do we start having charmers? And we start early. We start early. Believe me. The men we see who are in politics, they are bankrolled by either some private company or some other group. We have to have that wisdom to also start supporting our women. So International Women's Day,
we want to choose, we want to challenge. And personally, I choose to start challenging those barriers, those myths that make sure women, that do not allow women to take their positions of power. All those things that you get from the household, you know, when we talk about the personal is political. So the personal things, you know, starting to challenge that self-doubt that you might have in your mind, you know, telling your family, I want to be in politics, challenging all those things, all those myths, all those words that are said about, oh, women in politics are loose. That's what I want to choose to challenge today and say, I want to challenge all those things that are a barrier to women making a decision about what they want to do with their bodies, what they want to do with their education, when they want and where they want to sit and stand for, if it's standing in for a position. You know, I know it also happens here, but in Zim, if I'm to stand, I have to decide if I want to stand in the constituency where I was married. They'll say, you are a daughter-in-law. I'm sure you've heard this story, it's a broken record. You are a daughter-in-law, but that issue around a woman's identity and her not being able to choose to say, I want to just stand for this constituency. I want to stand for this community. I want to stand for this cause. That is what I want to challenge. And I want to challenge it from my personal, you know, personally, but also challenging it in the community, in the families, and in the work that we do. Challenging that violence, that toxic environment that women find themselves in when they are vocal online, when they say their mind online. Those are the things that I want to choose to challenge this International Women's Day. But most importantly, I also want us to celebrate. We should find time to celebrate, to just say today is our day. No matter what people say, in fact, today we should be, they should be clearing traffic for us in along the road. As long as we have this, women must lead. They should just clear the road because we are saying women are coming. And there's a song we sing, you know, it's an old song from my mother's time. But I know this song was sang here in Kenya just before the Beijing, at the Women's Fourth World Conference. And it's a song that African women were singing, and it goes as, women are coming around the corner, women are coming around the corner. Does anyone remember that song? No one used to sing. Or was it in the, maybe it's from the South.
Sing it in Shona.
I can't. But essentially there was, it's a song. So it says, women are coming around the corner. So they'll be saying, beware, women are coming around the corner. If you are comfortable in that seat, beware, women are coming around the corner. If you are about to abuse or if you are thinking of abusing women, beware, women are coming around the corner. So I think we are at a point in time globally where even as we talk about COVID-19 and we've seen how it has impacted women differently, I think this is about time. People have to hear us. People have seen how countries which are led by women have dealt differently with the COVID pandemic. So as women, we are leaders and women must lead. Even now, this theme of International Women's Day, which is calling us to stand up, to lead. Let's lead even in the discussions around the vaccines. Let's lead in everything to do with the plans and all the, you know, the stimulus packages. Where are they going? Let's voice out. As women, let's be heard. We know and we should be leading. So I just want to just say to you, thank you, Asante Nisana, Shukran. I hope you have a great day today. And I want to also just acknowledge the amazing team at FemNet. Doro, where is she? Dorothy. She hasn't been sleeping. She's been working with Helen, Halima. Sylvia, where are you? Femnet. When I say Femnet, just wave. Everyone, nice to see you. This is an amazing team. They are small. It's a small team, very young. I can safely say under 35, young team, all the energy. So thank you so much for Femnet team and also for our media team as well. I wish you a great day and great deliberations, and also to our speakers and our moderator, Asante Nisana.
Thank you. Memory, stand right here. I want you to sing after me, so we thank Memory. The word I want you to say is Malibongwe. Say Malibongwe. So all you're going to sing, Malibongwe, 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 Malibongwe. Let's go. Because Memory has to feel like she's at home, but she is. Okay? So Malibongwe, 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 ilama ya makaya taya Malibongwe, ikamala makosi kasi Malibongwe.
Okay, so the song says the name of a woman should be praised. So Igama Lama Kosi Kazi Malibongwe. Malibongwe just says praise, thank you. Yeah. Yes.
Please sing again.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah,
okay. Igama, not please. Please stand.
Okay,
I'm
yes.
I'm really excited. I'm sure you've noticed. Please stand.
Igama lama kosi kazi Malibongwe. Igama lama kosi kazi Malibongwe. 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 Malibongwe.
Thank you. Thank you. The thing about being a woman is that any part of the world, any corner you are, you feel at home. True or false? The Malibongwe that has been sung in my lifetime in the company of women. Memory has talked about support. As I welcome the next guest, I want to tell you something small. I want to ask you a question. When you are in pain, where you're not strong enough, whose hand are you squeezing? Whose hand do you squeeze when you are afraid, when you don't want to talk, when you're feeling down, when the stone is heavy on you? Whose hand are you squeezing? And you know the hand you squeeze, sometimes you don't even have to talk. The hand you squeeze feels it, so you don't have to explain that you're feeling pain. So on this International Women's Day, I have that question to ask. As women, as you go along, Caroline, as you go along, whose hand do you squeeze? So I love women and our spiritual nature, because God is our first port of call. Amen? Amen? And that is good. But here, in the human life where you sit, whose hand do you squeeze? For 2 months, I've been squeezing the hands of many women, several women. Some of those women are tiny like this, but they are wakali, they are KDF, they are wakali. Those women can give instructions. And those women can be mkali on you. Sit down. Take dawa. Go rest. We're going to the doctor. Breathe. Lie down. We can do it. Stand up. Me, I have women like that in my life. You see how big I am and loud. You've talked too much even. You go and sleep now. Now you rest. I want to appreciate a sister of mine who's working with me from across the border, who I know was meant to have come to me for many years. And so she's here with me as we battle, as we walk. In women's leadership, in whatever leadership, Jane, there has to be a hand you squeeze. There has to be hands you squeeze. Because if you're not squeezing hands, you fall. So you have to really reflect as I talk. Imagine, by the way, sometimes I actually talk sense. I request that you think about it. in your journey as women, as leaders, whatever, whose hands are you squeezing? The speaker, I call upon Helen Apila, my sister from across the region, who is a very special project person within FemNet. She will introduce herself. But I really wanted to take this opportunity to appreciate the hands of Helen that I keep squeezing. And I know sometimes I squeeze and they are quite, it's quite painful. That up until yesterday, I was squeezing Helen's hands at the doctor's clinic. So I want to appreciate Helen, not because she has given readily her hands to squeeze only, but because she has that heart for African women, and because she understands why bending the curve of women's leadership is important. You see how women talk important things. Yeah. Bending the curve of women's leadership on International Women's Day. Please clap for her. And clap, clap also for that person. Clap also for that person that you're thinking of right now, whose hands you squeeze matter. So just clap again for that person you're thinking of. Welcome, Helen. Welcome, Helen.
Thanks, Mildred. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, women. Good morning, African women. Greetings from Uganda. And greetings from Kenya. Greetings from Zimbabwe. Greetings from Nigeria. Greetings from South Africa. Greetings from Lesotho. Greetings from Rwanda. Greetings from Kigali. From Burundi. From Congo. From DRC. Congo Brazzaville. Everywhere. And Mozambique. Zimbabwe, yeah. Zambia, yeah. We can name all the 55, isn't it? Yeah. But we can't finish all of them. I come from the county number 48. Which is that one? Uganda. I've been adopted here, so I come from county number 48. I'm my own governor, I'm my own MCA, I'm my own. So I would like to invite some of you. In 2022, please come and join me in the county number 48. You're welcome. I love the song. I wish my sisters were here. Mildred, would you allow me? That song, Women Must Lead. Yes. Can we do that for now? Because we have to bend the curve. I'm going to talk about bend the curve, but we can't. We are bending it to what? To women in leadership. My sisters, please come. Let's bend this curve. And we are going to bend it together. As we do that, I'm inspired by Mildred. I'm inspired by all of you. I have met women here who are very strong, and they are so powerful that when I'm feeling low, I feel like I am letting them down. So I have to stand up again and again. And when I'm feeling like I'm falling down, I know that there are people like Jane Anyango. They will call me and they will say, Helen, you remember there are these young women in Kibera. There are these girls who are undergoing sexual harassment. What do we do about them? Can you support? There are women in Kisumu like Caroline Agwanda who will always send me a text. And they will say, Helen, you know what? I'm having this meeting. What should I say in this meeting? I have women like Hamisa in Mombasa. They will remind me that they have decided to challenge the status quo, no matter what. And there are women who are seated in front of us. They always remind us that it's possible to take those leadership positions and shine. My sister, women must lead. Would you like to stand up?
Yes.
Yes. Let's dance. Let's dance to this.
Machozi
Oh, yeah. Africa, oi! African women must live. We live.
Women must live.
We live.
We live.
We live.
Women lead Africa. Women lead Africa.
Yeah. And talk about the data. What does the statistics say about women in leadership in Kenya? Earlier on, when we saw the video that was playing, it showed that African governments had committed themselves to deliver on specific commitments to African women. And one of the key documents that they signed was the Maputo Protocol. And in that document, Kenya Inclusive, the Kenyan government signed to lift or to ensure that the position of women in leadership is 50-50, women to men. What is the current status? Why are we still in that status? Apart from the African Union Protocol, our governments also in 2015 made another commitment under the Sustainable Development Goals. And they committed to still lift African women by 50-50. Today, we are left with 9 years to the end of those commitments in 2030. Where do we stand as Kenya? Where are the women? How many have we achieved in those positions so far? Next slide. Feminet and partners have been looking at tracking the commitments that our governments are making. And the commitments that Kenya is making, we are tracking to show how the country is moving forward towards achieving this gender parity. Next slide. What we see, our governments committed to ensure that women in their full and effective participation have equal opportunities for leadership at all levels of decision making in political, economic, and public life. That is the target by 2030. So as we talk today, the indicators, next slide, the indicators that we'll be tracking, the first indicator wants to make sure that the proportion of women held by, the proportion of seats held by women in parliament and in local government is 50-50. That is the indicator. We will also be looking for the proportion of women in other managerial positions, those in cabinet, those in other positions. We just had one of our Mshimua is introduced here. She's in charge of ensuring that the registration process ensures that women will be in those positions. Next slide. That is the site where you'll find the data. Let's move on. So quickly, what are we leaning on at country level? Our constitution is very clear. It made a commitment of ensuring that there's equal access to the positions of leadership and decision making, that at least a third, that's the minimum. Are we there yet? That's the question we are going to discuss today. The other commitment is that if we can't achieve the a third, then what should we do to make sure that we get to 50-50 in the next 9 years? So in 2019, Femnet and Partners released a report, a global report, that showed that all over the world, 2.1 billion girls and women are living in countries where, to date, we can't achieve gender equality. 2.1 billion, including us here. To date, we still cannot achieve gender equality. It's also notable that in terms of government ministerial positions globally, only 23% are women. Ministerial positions, just ministers. Ministers can be appointed even outside those who competed politically, isn't it? So why is it that our governments cannot appoint more women, even into just ministerial positions? But we are also interested in women who will head, who will become heads of states, okay? Those who will stand for presidency, and they will be elected, and they become the presidents. So far, how many countries have had a female president in Africa? Two. Where and where? Malawi and Liberia. We clap for those countries, honestly. At least they are among the few countries all over the world, and they have pushed Africa to a higher level. You will also notice that in East Africa, although I've not mentioned it here, in East Africa, we have countries that are championing that lead. An example is Rwanda and South Africa. Okay? Rwanda and South Africa. So they are leading and they are pushing Africa to a level where we feel proud as a continent. But we also need to realize that when we come back into the country, where do we stand? We are still lagging behind. So it's a key question that we are going to discuss. Of course, while a record number of women were elected in Kenya in 2017, there is still a big gap. We only account for 21.8% in the National Assembly, and we are still at 31% in the Senate. So what about at the county? The percentage is lower. Next slide. So generally, this is the outlook. So for positions held by women in the National Parliament and in Senate, then we look at the ministers, we are at 22.7. That was by 2017. And as at 2019, the percentage of seats held by women at the county, we're looking at also the Supreme Court. Remember, without justice, it's difficult to achieve gender equality or women's rights. So it's key that we also monitor the leadership of women in the Supreme Court as well as in the whole judicial system. And the numbers are quite glaring. We are not yet there. We're not yet there. We are below the 50% mark. That's really annoying because our governments have made commitments, but they're not making any progress. Next slide. So this curve, if we're looking at just the ministerial positions, this is, if you see the dotted line, we would like to see growth as we head towards 2030, 32. We should be going upwards. But realistically, we have not made progress. So whatever conversations are happening now, we need to be heading towards that curve. The next slide. So when I say we need to bend the curve, this is what it means. For some countries, it may take 60 years to reach the 50-50 gender parity. For Kenya, it looks like this. So where we are currently is the thick line at the bottom. And where do we need to be by 2030? The thick line that goes up on the other side, the green, light green, that's where we need to go. But currently, if we are to reach there by 2030, then we need to bend that curve. You see the dotted line? We need to push that fast. Push that dotted line up to the thick line above. So if the current conversations that are going on that will prepare the way for the next election, if nothing major happens in favor of ensuring that women will be in these positions, it means there's a likelihood that we will even go down. So as we engage in the conversations, let's watch and see what is it that practically needs to be done. Because in the next election, at least the next election, which is next year, it should push us by halfway to where the dotted line is. Then the other election, which takes us to 2030, should actually bring us to the top curve. So that's where we stand. And it means people have to make radical decisions in favor of women to get into positions of leadership at all levels. That's a radical shift. So we really need to engage with sober minds, engage everyone appropriately. So without that, we can't achieve gender parity. For most of the African countries, some indicators, it will take 50 years, it will take 10 years. At least Kenya has made progress to the extent that from the calculations, in the next 10 years, which is just 2030, 31, we should be able to. The good thing is there is political will. So what do we do on ground? I think a lot of groundwork needs to be done to be able to push that curve, and we can do it. So we are doing fairly well. So let's go back with that in mind. We need to get to that. Let's bend the curve appropriately. Next slide. So for me, it's more of, it's possible. Yeah? The forecast shows that we can get there within the next 10 years by 2031. But it will take a lot of changes. Difficult decisions have to be made by the people in leadership to make sure that Kenya gets there. Even if we just got the 2/3, it will make a big difference. If we got 2/3 in this coming election, another 2/3 in the next election, it will make a big difference. Next slide. So as we go forward in our conversation today, we are going to discuss the following contributing factors. There is gender bias. We'll hear financial constraints. We'll hear political violence. There's propaganda. There's party politics. Of course, there's a lot of retrogressive culture and social perceptions. But today, we are challenging ourselves. And by the time we get out there, we shall be ready to challenge other people, isn't it? So we begin by challenging ourselves. So which of these contributing factors are we challenging with ourselves? And then how do we go and challenge others? And what challenge are we putting forward? Thank you very much, and have wonderful conversations.
Thank you. Thank you, Helen. A big clap again for Helen. A big clap again, really. So the reality that faces us as women on what we must do, ought to fight, ought to challenge so we lead, are real. Helen has made this presentation. It looks like, you know those people in class who are very bright than you? They write many things and you wonder, how come I didn't know that one? But the reality she has brought out is that we have 9 years to bend that curve to 2030. What are we doing about it? How are we doing it? The reality of the last slide where she says these are the challenges, financial issues, violence, you are getting all fights from the parties within, lack of resources, the challenges are real. You know, despite the challenges, Honorable Hamisa Zaja and Honorable Caroline Agwanda are going in 2021, come rain or sunshine. And I know there are other honorables in the room who've decided they are in. Why, there you'll be in good company. They are in many ways. Now, for the sake of this discussion going forward, I'll tell you something about Daisy. Somehow, whenever I'm in a platform and Daisy is there, I am at peace because I know she will throw the right fire. and will be down. And whenever you switch on TV, you see how you get uncomfortable and you're just seeing men that they want to talk about women issues. Men, with all due respect, it's okay, but really. Then you see Daisy there. Then you know she has reason. She's speaking for all of us. And that's what I love about Daisy. Today, you know, I'm trying to untwist Daisy. I've refused to have her bring out the technicalities. I'm not looking at her because she doesn't know that's how I've changed her program. I've refused. I've told her, come and speak about the soul of women's leadership. What's the soul? What's the soul of women's political leadership? Where is the soul? What do we ought to do? The reason why I'm pushing Daisy to speak like this is because she has researched it. She has unpacked it back and forth. She has she has dipped her feet in it. She has washed herself in it. She has walked it. She understands it. Daisy, what is the soul of women's leadership? Where is it? Do we have it? Do we need to cultivate it? Do we need to sustain it? What, in your view, is the soul? Please, a big clap and welcome Daisy to the podium.
Good morning, ladies. I want to thank FemNet for this opportunity, for inviting me to speak to you distinguished ladies. It is always a pleasure. I also want to thank FemNet for having the courage to have this conversation, because these are some of those uncomfortable conversations that women must learn to have, the ones that we are told we should not have, or we should not be involved in, the political conversations. And I want to thank Mildred, and even to appreciate you for your courage, for your love, enthusiasm, even despite the challenge right now, that you are here to encourage us and to show us the resilience of women. I really want to thank you and to appreciate you. And of course, to all of you who have made it out here. And of course now, Mildred has ambushed me on this topic because I thought I was speaking about something else. But nevertheless, you know, I think when we speak about women, because we are women, then we know how to speak about ourselves. But I think that one of the things that is really the soul of women is in their resilience and their ability to come together. And I think that this is something that we must harness as women. We are so good at doing it socially. Women come together socially. You know, there is this saying that men like to put out there, and some of you actually agree with it. And I want us to disabuse ourselves of that phrase and that idea. And we must not repeat it when we hear it. And when we hear it, we must challenge it. And that is this phrase where they say, who knows it? Exactly, Winnie Maru there, our good member. Women are their own worst enemies. Now, this is not true. It is not true. And I will tell you, and I will show you why it is not true. It is not true because women have for the longest time known how to come together to support one another in times of need. Because of cultural exclusion and economic exclusion, women came up with models. Today, banks celebrate them, and they even call them, these products of theirs, they call them investment products. Sindio. But women were doing it long time ago when, through merry-go-rounds and chamas, women were coming together and they were putting as little as 5 shillings in a pot so that this pot could go towards supporting one of their own and it would go round, hence the merry-go-round. At no point were women saying, I'm not going to put my coin inside the pot because it is going to benefit Daisy. Because they knew at some point that pot is coming round to me. When children are getting married, it is the women who come together. And they support one another to buy what is there, what is needed. When women are sick, when children are sick, when you are sick, who comes together? It is the women. However, because of the stereotype that we have been given, where when it comes to leadership, that is not the women's domain. Women have been socialized and trained to think lesser of women who aspire into political leadership. And so when women see women trying to get there, that old saying that says it is those women who are not good, those women who are kimbelembele, those women who are, not upright. Sindio? Awa mama ni wa malaya, ni wa mama waba. That it is those kimbelembele women, you know, who go for leadership positions. Because leadership is for men. And so because of that, women don't know how to operate in that sphere. And some of us still find ourselves that way. And that is the truth. Because just like when you go to a doctor, you know, you don't go and say, oh, I'm aching everywhere. You must say where you are hurting so that they can diagnose the problem. For us to get ahead, we must diagnose the problem and we must be deliberate about how we challenge it and how we redress it. So this idea that women have been trained to think that they are not qualified for leaders. In fact, there are those who call it the imposter syndrome, because women are made to think they are not qualified enough. In fact, when you see, look at applications, how many women apply? And yet we have so many qualified women, but they are afraid to apply. Why? Because somehow women just feel like they're imposters. It's like you're going into a space that you're not supposed to be in, you know? But who said that that space is not ours? In fact, today, I want us to challenge that system that has decided that because of a lottery of birth, ladies, it is a lottery of birth. Who here signed up to be born as a woman? Hands up. So who here signed up to be born as a man? So who decided that they have more rights than women? They have more opportunities than women. It's systems. They create systems for exclusion. So we must choose to challenge that system that has given male dominance preeminence, and that system that says that women have no right in the leadership sphere. How can we have no right in the leadership sphere? Yes, Winnie, I can see yours. I choose to challenge male privilege. That's what it's called, that male privilege. And no offense to you men, we are not saying that we want the men to stay back. You know, when you read the scriptures, I am a Christian. When you read the Bible tells us that when Yahweh created everything, he said, he saw and he said it was good. And it was good, very good. But there is one place where he said it is not good. And that was to say, men, without women, you are nothing. Because he said it's not good for man to be alone. And we are saying it's also not good for men to be alone in that leadership sphere. Yes. It isn't. If Yahweh said it is not good for you, because he gave the call to dominate, he said, go forth and replenish and exercise dominion over the earth. And he gave this mandate to both man and woman. He didn't give it to the man alone, because he said, man, you can't be on your own doing this. So why are men saying that they want to be alone doing this? What system? That system, we must challenge that system, because it is the one that has given rise to this skewedness. So women's soul is in that being able to come together. But there are also some things that we need to learn as women. We also need to learn how to separate issues. And this is something that the men do very well. In politics, politics is about interests. Please understand me. While we know that leadership and politics is about who gets what, where, when, how, but primarily it is about interests. in Kenya, those interests have been framed around tribe. Okay? Even now, even as we look at the BBI, debate, it's really about tribe, you know, tribal grouping. Okay? Now, tribes are patriarchal in nature, meaning that they accede to male privilege. So tribe will never coalesce around women. That is one reason why it becomes difficult for women to ascend within a tribal setting, which is why we push different angles. We have the two-thirds gender principle, because remember that the law is a tool for social change, okay? For instance, we know that there are parts of this country, if it was left to chance, women would never be elected no matter what. When we talk about our sisters in the northern part of Kenya, where the clans reign supreme and those clans are dominated by men and they are the ones who say vile kutaenda, they dish out leadership positions on the basis of clans. So this clan will get this and this clan will get that. And of course, the clan is never represented by women. But for the law, we have a constitution that says every county must elect a woman leader. So it doesn't matter what the culture and the elders are saying, you must elect a woman leader by universal suffrage. It doesn't matter what the culture is saying, at the county level, you must have a minimum of a third of the opposite gender. So, by law, contrary to culture, women are sitting in positions of leadership from those counties. In those county assemblies, women are sitting in. From that county, from those counties, women are sitting in the National Assembly. So the law is a very important tool in being able to redress many of the barriers that our sister showed us here. Okay? Now, as women, what are we doing about it? I would want to hear what our sister Juliet from the ORPP, the Registrar of Political Parties, is saying. But as women, how are we coming together for our interests? Okay? What are our interests? Your interests, by the way, are not represented by your tribal leaders. Do you understand this? It is 10 years post-promulgation of the Constitution. We have not even reached ground zero. A third is the starting point. Please understand what the two-thirds is. The not more than two-thirds gender principle is ground zero. That's where we are supposed to start from. To achieve that 50-50 that we are aspiring to in Vision 2063, that Africa will have a third. Kenya, we have not begun the journey. Even though we have the highest number of women ever since independence, we have not begun the journey because we have not reached the minimum threshold. But why? Why haven't we reached this minimum threshold? One, because there's a lack of political will from the highest level, from the presidency. There is no will. And let me tell you what political will looks like. Have you seen how BBI is being pushed? That's what political will looks like. That when you want something or when something needs to happen, you make it happen, okay? The law means nothing on the paper that it is written on until it is implemented. So if you want to see political will, so don't tell me, because I've been hearing women saying the president means well for us. No, he has demonstrated by his actions that he does not. Because we have seen when he wants, he railroads it. Nobody has railroaded anything because of women. But guess what? We have also allowed him to. We have allowed our political parties to do that. We have allowed our political leaders. And this is not reserved to President Kenyatta only. Even Raila Odinga, where in ODM do they have the two-thirds? Even Kalonzo Musyoka, where in Wiper do they have the two-thirds? Which political party right now as we speak has a mechanism to guarantee two-thirds, not more than two-thirds? Is there any? Somebody said yes. Okay, she'll tell us. Okay, which one? Have you not known? Yes. But what do? We follow. We follow after those ones and we dance. And let me tell you, that is our undoing. Okay? That is our undoing. Do you know why it is so easy to shortchange women politically? Because there is no political cost to shortchanging women. Do you understand what that means? Do you understand what I've just told you? Do you know what political cost is? Political cost means if I don't give you what I promised, I lose politically, okay? Just a few years ago, Raila Odinga and Uhuru Kenyatta were at odds with one another, isn't it? This country was literally ablaze. Raila refused to recognize Uhuru's presidency. Not so? Said, you are illegitimate. His followers also said, you are illegitimate. And guess what? It became very difficult for him to govern the country. So what did he do? The political cost of continuing on that journey for him was very difficult. It was easier to do the handshake. And what did the handshake do? It calmed the Raila and his followers, but it also gave him the legitimacy he needed. That's what political cost is. So here we are, women. We are over 50% of the population. We are a strong, solid block if we come together. We can determine who becomes president of this country. Actually, we can determine leadership at any level, okay? Yet, it is so easy for our political leaders to shortchange us. Why? Because there's no political cost. Uhuru refused to implement the two-thirds gender rule in his first term. What did women do? Organized and gathered to mobilize for him to be elected for a second term. So, why should he give you people what is rightfully yours? And please remember that it is not even him giving it to us. Women are inherently equal. The Constitution recognizes that. The non-discrimination clause is the one that says you must make sure that they are not more than two-thirds of the same gender. So when you go to a leader telling them, please give us, he can't give us. It's not his to give. But what he does by refusing to implement it is that he is exercising veto power over the Constitution and over our inherent rights. Do you understand that? Now, when that happens, you lose all the way. Because now we have been losing. You know, when he came into office, he was trying. He tried with cabinet. He tried, but he saw these women, they don't get it. They don't get it. We can shortchange them. And you know what? They did. By the time his second cabinet was coming around, cabinet is not compliant. Parliament is not compliant. It doesn't even have the cover of the law. Civil service is not compliant. Diplomatic corps is not compliant. Nothing is compliant. Yet, here we are. Women are not outraged. And we are saying women must lead. There must be a pathway for women to lead. There has to be a pathway, and we must follow it. To be able to bend that curve, we need to go 2 times faster. How are we going to go 2 times faster when we don't even recognize that we are being shortchanged all along and that we are not coming together to bring our numbers together? Let me tell you, if as the women of Kenya we came together and we made a declaration, just one declaration, and say, we will not support the BBI, and we are not supporting any of these leaders. Maria Powerson is our presidential candidate. Do you know that they will pay attention? They will pay attention. But how many of us are willing to do that? How many of us are willing to separate issues? These men, these political leaders, they are not your husbands. They are not your sons. They are not your fathers. They are not your brothers. They are political leaders, and they operate on interests. How many times have you seen them even calling women to the table? Have you seen them? Have you seen women organizing around it? Do you think we are going to get anything? Do you think we're going to get anything? The same people who have denied you your inherent rights, do you think that they are going to give them to you now when you do nothing? In Iceland, there's the iconic meeting they had where all the women downed their tools. Are we able to do that? Are we? No, I mean, are we really able to do that? That's the thing. We must learn how to do that. And let me tell you, right now, the real threat of losing the two-thirds is, the threat of losing the two-thirds is real. It is real. Because once they open up the Constitution in a referendum, there are only 10 issues that go to referendum. Bill of Rights is one of them. That's why they've not been able to get rid of the two-thirds, because it is in the Bill of Rights. The one thing that you need to do to open up the Bill of Rights is to go for a referendum. And who has told you that they are not going to change things? Have you seen that the BBI changed? What was unveiled in Bomas changed? What was in, to, from what was unveiled in KICC? Who tells you they will not change it? Parliament is facing dissolution right now. Maraga, Chief Justice Emeritus David Maraga gave us the political cost. He gave us the political cost, ladies. What have we done with it? Do you know what that political cost is? Do you know what it is? Somebody here, not from back here, somebody here, not and not Winnie, tell me, what is the political cost that Maraga has given us? Eh? So you know what the political cost is. The Chief Justice told the president to dissolve parliament. Do you know? That's a major thing. We are the only ones who have done anything about it. We've gone to court. We are trying, we are running a campaign, but it's been difficult. In fact, we had a meeting with FemNet. We actually said parliament should be dissolved, but it didn't gain traction. Why are we not calling for the dissolution? Let me tell you. If parliament is dissolved, it is game shot. Women, it will never be shortchanged again. Do you understand that? And parliaments have been dissolved around the world. Egypt, their parliament was dissolved. Where else? I think Uzbekistan, their parliament was dissolved. Ukraine, their parliament was dissolved. This country is so steeped in impunity that even when an order is given by the Chief Justice, the president doesn't follow. Why are we not pushing for the dissolution of parliament? Tell me. Tell me. Why haven't all the women joined together to say, yes, dissolve parliament? We are not going to bend that curve. They are in the process right now of shortchanging us. How many of you have read the BBI? Which you are being told women's gains in the BBI. There are no women's gains in the BBI. They have removed 47 women from parliament and from the National Assembly and taken them to the Senate. The National Assembly, where national budgets are held and debated, where they plan to take cabinet secretaries, cabinet ministers out of, they've removed the women. The way they have framed the two-thirds, special seat members necessary to ensure not more than two-thirds of the members of parliament are of the same gender. Parliament is a bicameral house. So they have taken the women to the Senate. When you say not more than two-thirds of the members of parliament, it means they will count Senate and National Assembly. So you will still be thin in the National Assembly. They have put a sunset clause on both the Senate of the parliament and in the counties. They've put a sunset clause for the two-thirds gender principle. Yet, the two-thirds gender principle is supposed to stand in perpetuity. As in, never again in the Republic of Kenya will there ever be, should there ever be, more than two-thirds of the same gender. So, don't believe it when they tell you that they are gains for you. There are no gains for you. There are apparent gains, but they are being taken away slowly. In fact, women are being erased pole pole. Even where it worked, even the formula, the way they are saying it, the way it is being done, it's trying to remove the responsibility from political parties. It says, oh, women who have vied and lost are the ones to be given opportunity. Okay? When you recognize Article 27.6 of the Constitution says that because of marginalization, there are things that women have suffered. We know economic marginalization. You showed us the barriers. One of it is economic hardship. Women don't have disposable income to run campaigns. So when you say that women will have to vie before they get the right to be nominated, you refuse to recognize that women, there are those women who do not have resources to run a campaign. And therefore, you begin to make leadership the preserve of the elite. Okay? That is what the colonial government did. When they didn't want natives in, they put a criteria on who would qualify for leadership. You had to have a certain income to qualify for leadership. You had to have a certain level, you had to have been in leadership positions. So automatically, if you didn't have money, if you didn't have access to those opportunities, automatically you were cut out. It was made the preserve of the elite. And so when you say that women must vie to qualify for nomination, you negate Article 27.6 of the Constitution, which says affirmative action measures should be put in place in recognition of the discrimination and marginalization those groups have faced. So don't be deceived. You know they are counting on women not critically analyzing things. They have not even made it available for everybody to read. And I'm saying this because this is the biggest threat right now to women's gains and to the gains that we celebrate in the Constitution 2010. And remember that as soon as Justice Maraga gave the advisory for the dissolution of parliament is when the BBI was released. So it was to shift people's attention from that weight. So he has given us that political cost. Why are we not running with it? Why are we not running with it? So when I talk about the soul of women, the soul of women, the soul of women is in their nature, their resilience, their strength, but also in their ability to be able to quickly organize. This is one thing I like about women. They are able to very quickly organize, and we've seen this. Short notice, you know, women are able to do so much with so little. We have so little time. We can do so much with it. But the first thing is, are we willing to come together? Are we willing to say, you know what? Let's break ranks. Let's break ranks. Let's break ranks with our political leaders. Let's break ranks with tribe. Would tribe ina tusaidia nini? Those tribes, there is no single tribe in Kenya that does not have an exclusion mechanism for women. Not a single one. Do you know of any? You are discriminated against because you are a woman. All those tribes have discrimination mechanisms against women. So why? What is this Mtuetu syndrome that women galvanize around? It's easy. You see, it's easy to coalesce around tribe because the only thing I need to do is to be your tribe. I don't need to be anything else. But you see, even as a woman, even that tribe refuses to recognize you. How many council of elders have we seen endorse a woman? Eh? They will even go and get the worst possible man and make him the spokesperson of the tribe. And they will leave the women behind. So what are women doing running at ECGU? You are supporting your political leader. Your political leader who has refused to support you. That's what politics is about. Why do you think they are having difficult time? Just in 2007, Uhuru Kenyatta and Ruto were not together, were they? By 2013, it was in their political interests to come together. What did they do? They came together and they made a political juggernaut and they said, my brother, Now it is no longer politically expedient for them to become together. Now are they calling each other brother? They have found new brothers. Why are we not able to do this as women? Why can't we say my sister? Why can't Waithera leave Jubilee? Eh? And my sister Mweshimiwa, there. Why can't you leave ODM and we say we come together as women? Why? Why can't we come together and say this? Moi used to do it all the time. Moi would wake up, you know, there was a time Moi used to reign like a king. Parliament in Namsumbwa, they would wake up and find parliament has been prorogued. That is to say, dissolved. And a snap election, 90 days, what wajipange? And remember, with the dissolution of parliament, counties are still there. The executive is still there. So Kenya will not die. In fact, Kenya will probably be saved because this is the worst parliament in the history of independent Kenya. Why can't we coalesce around the dissolution of parliament? Tell me. That must be the declaration of International Women's Day here in Kenya. Dissolve parliament. Follow through on Chief Justice Maraga's advisory, Mr. President, dissolve parliament. This is the same parliament that has taken us down the tubes, everything. They have failed. They are the ones who have approved those cabinet members that do not meet two-thirds. They are the ones, by the way, they have helped in sabotaging the two-thirds gender principle. They pass everything. Lakini, when two-thirds come, they move away from it. And who has told you that BBI is going to bring anything better? The constitution right now is the one that says two-thirds. What stops them, again, from deciding it's not convenient? Why? And for how long will women continue to be foolish? The soul of women is that they are trusting, yes. But you know what? At some point, it is time kuerevuka. And so for me, I know I have completely deviated. We must challenge the system that imagines that women will continue to play this game. We must challenge the system that continues to shift the goalposts every time we are getting close. And we must demand for the dissolution of parliament. If we're going to bend that curve, we must demand for the dissolution of parliament. Let me tell you, if we come together and we make a declaration for parliament to be dissolved, even the president will call us. He will call us to the table. But parliament should be dissolved. Because unless there is a political cost to shortchanging women, we are not going to break through. And that is where our numbers count. And because we are so good at coming together when we need to, I think it's time for us to come together around the issue of the dissolution of parliament. That will be such a game changer, and it will shift the balance completely for women. And then women, we will not be saying women must lead. We will be saying women are leading. Yeah. Thank you.
You know, you should be saying, dissolve parliament, dissolve parliament, dissolve parliament. Is there media in the house apart from myself? Wonderful. Daisy. Two things, Honorable Waithera and Honorable and Senator Rose Nyamunga should just ditch their parties and come together as women. Allow me to acknowledge Senator Rose Nyamunga, who has just walked in. Thank you, thank you, thank you for coming in. Thank you. When Daisy unpacks the issues as they are, they come to life. And it's the reality. We are being shortchanged in a tuna smile too. So there is something my mother always tells me. My sister is here, so she can attest. I'll introduce you at some point. My mother says, panya anakuuma akikupuliza. Jen, you can translate it in French. Panya anakuuma akikupuliza. What Daisy is saying is that all the time, women wanaumwa, wanapulizwa. Wanaumwa, Hawaski. But listen, the conversations are hot. I want to hold it there. I could see Honorable Waithera wanted to get off her seat, and that's a good thing. I wanted to get off her seat and off political parties and go to women parties like us. So I want to welcome Honorable Waithera. Remember that I said earlier that we, as Femnet, have decided she's ours. As in, it's not a choice she's making. But I want Honorable Waithera Chege to really come in and talk to us about, does affirmative action guarantee meaningful participation of women in politics? Does it guarantee? Does it guarantee? I want to give you 10 minutes, 10 golden minutes to hit us like that, having in mind what Daisy has challenged us to do, including yourself. Welcome, a big clap for Honorable Waithera. Welcome.
Thank you, our MC. My leaders, all of them are my leaders because I've passed through their hands in one way or the other. And the guests in this room today, good morning. Or it's afternoon. Good afternoon. My name is Waithera Chege. I'm elected MCA in South D. I'm also the Deputy Majority Whip, Nairobi County Assembly. And I'm also the Chair of the Political Desk on Anti-Terrorism. Adieu, Anti-Terrorism. So, I don't know what to say after Daisy speaks. You know, she usually pushes us to the corner, and also to remind her that she went to a group of schools. When some of us went to polling station schools. So Daisy, I've been with her in the women's political journey, and I can assure you, when Daisy is against you, you can be sure. I don't know how you'll be counting the percentages. Having said that, Daisy also forgot to tell you that she's a member of Leader Katiba. Me today, I lead government business in the assembly. So we might not necessarily be on the same side on some issues. But I also need to remind her that the leader of Leader Katiba, who is Honorable Martha Karua, was my political teacher. And I've been her political student for a long time after I was handed over to her by Honorable Alice Wahome. So you can be sure that link of the women's journey in the political leadership, I've been mentored by quite a good number of good women in this country. My friend Juliet Muremi, I've also been with her along this journey before even she joined the office of the Registrar of Political Parties. And I must also say that FEMNET, which is led by Memory, has also been part of my journey. Having said that, I was invited here. You know, Mildred always wants to keep on pushing me, but I've been very happy to join FEMNET because of several issues. I see the group of Akinawini here. We have slept on the streets, asking that not women, please note the difference, asking that young women must be allowed to lead. Because what happened is that when the age of Akina Phoebe Asiyo, Martha Karua, and the like took the center stage, young women were left behind. And not only just left behind, because we were there, we realized with quite a good number of young women here that there was also no space for young women when women were leading. So the reason why we came on board was so that young women can also be able to be recognized within the women's movement. And that is what we have been pushing. Even before I was elected, we did so many events and so many meetings asking the leaders of women movement to also recognize the leadership of young women within the women's movement. And that is what, even up to this day, I look up to all women who are mentoring young women along this journey. I see Akina Hamida here, who has been running for MP Kibra constituency. And I see so many other women who've been running for seats. One of the things I wish to remind, and I still come back to Daisy because I also need to demystify some of the things that she has spoken about here. And one of the things that me and Daisy, we are not on the same side, is that personally I'm for BBI because of several reasons. And which reasons I could have been ready to take you through here today, although now one of our agendas to guide us here is not BBI. One of the things that Kenyan women who gave their presentation during the committee was that Kenyan women were asking to sichaguliwe affirmative seats through girlfriends. Siyo ndio mambo mliuliza? Because nomination seats, as you have been saying, most of them, according to you, have been brought about by either someone was someone's girlfriend or someone was someone's sister. Now, what BBI is saying is that any woman who want to be nominated after 2022 must go to the ground and seek for that position first. Kama hutachaguliwa. In fact, BBI, in my own terms, is talking about the best loser. Kama hutachaguliwa, na huko nakula nyingi kushida, wale wengine wote hawakuchaguliwa, you are the person to be nominated. And that is one of the things that Kenyan women asked when the committee sat. Number two is that IEBC must check all the party seats that is well catered for. So one of the days that Feminet will call us here, we will also be able to break down that BBI. But because today that was not the agenda, I thought it was also important that I mention that and that to remind Kenyans that this thing of saying that women are going to Senate, that it's not a good thing, I can assure you I've served in a county assembly. And one of the most powerful things you can do as a senator is to oversight 47 counties in this country. Because the monies, all the monies that are going to county assemblies, all the 316 billion, it is the senator's work to oversight that money. I do not want to say, and I do not want to get into the discussion of whether women are being brought down by being told to go to the Senate or being told to go to the National Assembly. You have seen, also BBI is asking, that for us to be able to fill in the affirmative action seats, we are going to use the county assembly's strategy, which is a plus, because before then, they were nominating 12 members to the National Assembly. So all the seats, it is now upon Kenyans to elect women in 2022. If they fail to elect women in 2022, then they will have to be nominated to go to the National Assembly. And it is important. In my ward, I've given out the copies of BBI. It is important wherever you are, there's a chief near you, there's a church near you, all these copies are there. The newspaper, I think Nation and Standard, last week but one, they had put the whole document in the newspaper. So those who are unable to reach and to get a copy of BBI, I know those copies are available, and those who don't have, you can always get back to me. Having said that, I was told there are women who are seeking to run for office in 2022. And I will very quickly just highlight some of the things and how you need to prepare if you are seeking for a seat. Number one, you need to ask yourself whether you are qualified for that seat you wish to seek for. Many people stand up and say, yes, I want to go for an elective seat. There are qualifications and disqualifications in our constitution today. You need to ask yourself before you go announcing that you want to run for office, am I qualified for the presidential position? Am I qualified for the governor's position? Am I qualified for the parliamentary? Whichever position you are seeking for, the first question, you should go to the constitution, check the qualifications and the disqualifications of that position. Once you do that, ask yourself whether you are ready to go for that position. Number three, ask yourself whether you have the financial capability. And when we always talk about financial capability, we are not talking about pesa ya kwenda kupatia watu kwa crowd. There is so much. Next time, if you have time, I'll give you a breakdown of how to use that budget. In 2013, I ran on Na Kenya ticket in Nairobi. And the people from my area asked me to join a popular party. In 2013, I refused. And I told them, I want to be elected because of my manifesto, of who I am, my good standing in the society, and those all other attributes. But one of the things that I was reminded by my voters, that for Nairobi, you have either to be in ODM or Jubilee, either in TNA or what was there then, ODM and TNA still. And because I have experienced it, it is good to align yourself to a political party. I know there are people who would prefer to run as independent candidates. But political parties in this country play a key role in your political leadership. I said I was mentored by Na Kenya before I joined Jubilee. But I didn't join Jubilee because it was my party of choice. In terms of the things I was looking out for in a political party, Na Kenya then was my party of choice. But my voters pushed me to the wall to go and run on a Jubilee ticket. A political party is something that you need to think about when you are seeking for office. Because Kenya is yet to get to where me and you are. Until we get there, that is when we can now start thinking about, can I run as just an individual? When you're running for office, there are several things that people maybe sometimes you don't consider. But nowadays, I tell people to consider something called social media, especially if you are running in an urban setup. Social media today is playing a key role in when people are running for office. Because you have to keep on marketing your manifesto, we have such a huge group of young people who are in social media. And you need to keep on reminding people why you are running. There are people who run and they don't inform their families. A family is a fundamental component if you're running for office. It is important, before you make your decision to run, engage your family. If you're married, it is important that you talk to your husband. If you're not married, engage your parents and brothers and sisters. There are people who run for office. At the middle of your campaigns, now you start seeing your family members doing a press conference, saying, sasa huyu atukusikizana. See, we saw in Machakos. Yes, there was a press conference by family members saying that we would want our mother not to run for office. It is good that you consult your family if you want to run for office.
And fathers don't consult.
We'll push them to start. It may not be consulting as you may think, but sometimes your family members may also be more financially stable than you are, and you may really want them to support you along this journey. So it is important. I'm just advising it is important because we have seen in the past that these things have happened. Let me tell you something. The minute you are elected, you think that now you have succeeded. In my first 6 months in office, I personally almost resigned. Unaona hiyo city hall? We now call it Kapendo. You know what happens at Kapendo? Sinivita. You have been watching Nairobi County Assembly fighting. You'd think that by the time you are announced as the winner, that now you can go home and relax. I want to remind you that is when now the journey properly starts. We get into that assembly, and again, all men now start saying they will be now in charge of the leadership in the assembly. And I thank God that the Office of the Registrar of Political Parties is here. Because also, in these 47 county assemblies, women should be demanding that we need to get two-thirds of the leadership of the county assembly. And one of the things that really makes us also not achieve this is what I call standing orders. You know, even if now we are working with the Constitution of Kenya, there are standing orders in the county assembly. And some of these standing orders, you realize that members can change these standing orders in the morning, and that standing order, whatever has been changed, will be working in the afternoon. You saw the case of your friend, Honorable Bitty Selachi. You know the standing orders were changed that morning. They worked at 2 p.m. And you could throw out anybody, anybody. And you know now, out here, you cannot change the standing orders. The only people who can change the standing orders are the members of the county assembly. So that's another area, I think, FEMNET. We need to do training to the county assemblies on. Because those standing orders can also make women lose the leadership of the assembly. And let me also remind you, within the same assembly, whether county assembly or national assembly, there are committees. If women don't demand that you also get a third of chairmen of those committees, I want to assure you that in that assembly, there is nothing you're going to do. Because the leadership of those committees will again now go down to something called the budget process. The budget process will be catered for all these sectors. And if the women leadership is not part of leadership of those committees, that is where we still lose. Because men will still take their time. During that budget making process, that is where you are able to get your projects into that budget. If you do not make it to get your projects into those budgets, then somebody will be saying, you are also not able to deliver for your ward. So all these things put together, they are very, very important for us. And I would really ask, for those people who are preparing to run for office, as I tell you, it's not a walk in the park, but I also remind you, if we don't work together as a team of women wanting other women to lead, we might find ourselves again walking up the hill. Otherwise, I wish you all the best. I hope to meet you soon. And please, Daisy, we are looking forward to meet ahead. I am for BBI. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Honorable Waithera. And you know, one of the things we encourage women in leadership to do is to stand firm in what they choose and how they go about it. So we affirm your stand. We absolutely do. Thank you. Another clap for Honorable Waithera. Another clap. You know, Honorable Waithera, when you're saying inform your family and have a discussion, the list of the questions they ask us women when we are running was going on in my head. I'll give you the list. I even know it offhand. It's like number one up to 2019, 2015. So while I'm doing that list, may I ask for a roving mic to be brought closer here to Honorables Hamisa and Honorable Carol. May I have a roving mic? Dorothy? But you do realize, Honorable Hamisa and Honorable Carol, you are already honorables in my eyes. How that turns out, by the way, and how it continues, you do realize it's done. You do realize, Nyamin. Yeah. So, roving mics. So now, Honorable Waithera, let me tell you. You say today you want to run for president. Who is she? Who is her husband? How many children does she have? Who was her boyfriend in secondary? How many women has she fought? Has she talked to her father? Has she talked to her big brothers? Does the clan allow her? Do the in-laws know? Have they allowed? How short is her skirt? Where does she go to dance? What does she drink? Who does she hang around with? What does she stand for in terms of the church she goes to? Which religion does she go to? Did her priest and her imam approve? You still want me to continue, Honorable Waithera? You know, sometimes they even want the women to declare the men that they've had in their lives since they were 13. And I've had many crushes. And it's hard. It's hard. And because of that, before I call Juliet, because Juliet is going to give us some sobriety, I want to ask Hamisa Zaja, our power woman from Mombasa. You know, when Hamisa roars in Mombasa, you hear it in Nairobi. And if you don't know Hamisa, you'll have to come to where she sits because she's don't touch it. Hamisa Zaja has run before in Mombasa. She's going to run again and she's going to win. And she's going to win. But I want to ask Hamisa, from the quick presentations you've had from Honorable Adera, from Daisy, what do you think is the biggest impediment when you want to lead as a woman? Actually, a woman living with a disability from Mombasa, yet the challenges are many. What is the biggest impediment in your view, Hamisa?
The campaign trail. So many things like a lot of violence during rallies. And you look at yourself that you cannot run. And a lot of things like you would need to, there's this campaign trail that is called door to door. Watu wengine wenye kupiga kura wako sehemu zinaitwa madongo poromoko. So you have to go to madongo poromoko. You have to go where people are drinking mangwe. You have, those are the so many things that, because they have been normalized, and you need to do them. Those are the challenges that when you think of running, you think of that. So you look for solutions, quick solutions. Like in 2017, I had to look for a very quick solution. But other people also copied. They thought it is a style. Because I could not reach the Madongo Poromoko, where the mangoes are, what I did is I made small cards with my agenda, saying I'll do the issues of water with partnership, I will do the issues of, because those are the issues on the ground. And people thought those are styles. And they copied me.
Copied your style. They copied. You see, women lead, others follow. They just don't want to admit it. So Hamisa is running. Please, a big clap and well wishes to Hamisa. What Hamisa needs is collaboration and support, people. Remember, whose hands will Hamisa be squeezing as she fights and battles? Whose hands will Hamisa... Remember in the morning, I actually told you I speak sense. Whose hands, Winnie, is Hamisa squeezing as she moves? Okay, Hamisa, Winnie, ameshaweka mkono. Mkono wake ule pale. Utamchukua. A big clap. Support. Support the women. Support the women. May I bring the mic over here to Honorable Carol Agwanda, coming in from Kisumu. You know, Caroline, hey, we know you are a fighter. We know you are relentless. Hey, Caroline, hey. I know for a fact, the blood that flows in Caroline's blood... flows in mine. And it's not easy. Jane, is it easy? It's not easy. Caroline, we have outlined those challenges that women face. They are trying to lead, but the challenges are real. How do we fight? How do we fight? You know, Waithera has really pricked my conscience and disturbed me a bit when she said, now we have to discuss. It's okay, I've heard, it's a good suggestion. But I want the men also to ask our permission. I want also to ask the men, who did you sleep with? How many wives do you have? How much money do you... Let me, I want to ask the men. I want to ask the men. I want the questions to be equal. So that we can worry, we ask the men, how many girlfriends do you have? How many mpango akandos? How many children? The ones we know and the ones we don't know. Caroline, we appreciate that you came. Talk to us about really navigating that challenges very briefly and why you feel it is still feasible and women ought to go for leadership.
Thank you. My name is Agwanda Caroline. I'm a former member of County Assembly of Kisumu. I was nominated. I was representing people with disabilities, and I am the first in Kenya to have come up with a county disability law, which has been adopted by all counties in Kenya. I'm a student of, she's called who? Elsa? Daisy. Yeah, she trained me at Manzoni when I was vying for Kisumu Central MP position.
Mm-hmm.
Apart from that, what I believe in for women to be in leadership positions, sorry, currently I'm an advisor to the governor of Kisumu on women, youth, and people with disabilities. I believe in teamwork. for us to lead and fight for our issues, we need to embrace one another.
Yeah.
We need to look at what are some of the laws and some of the government commitments in regards to women issues.
Mm.
When you go to meetings, can you articulate such issues? We need to have programs that empower women economically. When you go to meetings, people will look at how you dress, how you speak, where you live. So it's important for women to be economically empowered. So we need to have programs that supports women to be economically empowered. And for you to also vie, you need money.
Mm.
As you vie, you'll need to pay your security a lot of money as a woman, more than men, the way they do theirs. And for a woman with disabilities, you'll double that. So funds is very key for a woman aspirant. It's also important for you to be aligned to a political, a member of a political party. And you must participate in your party activities. And your visibility is key. And yeah. What you do to the community also matters. So I feel it's important to network in the community. You need to be known.
Yeah.
Work closely with the media for your visibility of what you do.
Mm.
Get funds to support you. Be active in your party leadership.
Mm.
I've also been mentored by the Honorable Senator seated here from before I even thought of going to VI. She used to buy my craft that I was selling. I'm a UN award winner for innovation.
Ooh.
So Senator Nyamunga used to support me when I was still selling in a small table at Kisumu Airport.
Mm.
I had not even thought of VI.
Mm.
Whenever she was passing there, she would pass by and say, Jaber. Jaber means mrembo.
Mm. And you are.
What new products do you have today? She could buy and even pay you more than what she's buying.
Mm.
So having women like that.
Support! Women must support each other.
Having women like that in, you were talking of squeezing somebody's hand.
Yes,
she
the hand
there
is squeezed.
To lift me and hold me.
Yes.
And other women, thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Honorable Senator Nyamunga, the microphone is yours because there's no way I can forgive myself without hearing your voice. Honorable Senator, what we have heard repeatedly in our platforms for women's political participation is that there is no enough mentorship. Memory, we hear it all the time. The young women leaders, the new ones coming into leadership, feel that they're not mentored enough. And in our meetings as FEMNET, we keep asking the older leaders, the trailblazers, the ones ahead, we ask them, who are you mentoring? So I want to start by asking, we've already heard you've mentored, so you already have a plus. Please clap for that. But we see a huge gap in mentorship when it comes to women in leadership. I see the toughness of Waithera, and I know she was thrown into the sharks and she learned to swim immediately. But many women are not able to do that. What are your views, Honorable Senator?
Thank you very much. First of all, I must apologize. I came in late. I was actually in Kisumu and was meant to have attended the International Women's Day, which was organized by the county government. But in the morning, I got a phone call from one of my PA, I mean just a PA, to tell me that the governor's wife said that I should not attend that meeting. So I was so shocked.
Why?
I have no idea. I went to the airport, entered any plane that I could get, and here I am.
Thank you Thank you for coming.
Very, very disappointed, but that is for another day.
No, we embrace you. Yes. Us, we want you. We want you here. Thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, so that is coming from another woman to a woman.
Yeah.
And those are the issues that we are raising. From Agwanda, I'm not praising myself, but I must say that in my life, I've always made it very, very critical in my life to uplift other women, to make women around me much better. I was in Kisumu County, and I've identified five women, the women that we've worked with, that I think should now run.
Yeah.
And I told them, you are going to run in this ward. They are MCS. We have not gone to the level of a National Assembly or the Senate.
Mm.
But I told them, from what I've seen over the years, because we've worked together, you are going to run here, you are going to run here. They had all their reasons, but I told them, with or without money, you are going to run, we are going to support you, we are going to make sure that if you don't get it, number one, at least we don't want nominated women from the house.
Yeah.
We want people who've been in the field, people who understand. When we talk over, Agwanda can talk, we can talk about each other forever because we have come from far. And I told her, you know, you are going to go very far. You know, just do your thing. And we would laugh and laugh and laugh. Little did we know that actually she's going to go far.
Yeah.
And we believe that this time she's going to contest again. And by God's grace, she'll be able to get it.
Yeah.
But what is very critical is, who do you hold? Whose hand do you hold?
Yes.
And how do you do it?
Yeah.
You don't stand on a platform and start saying, no, I'm going to hold this woman and I'm holding this and I'm holding this. And no. Let them see you. Agwanda used to see me.
Mm.
Oh, I love the way you dress, the way I dress. Mm.
I love the dress.
It was not, I'm not that flashy type of woman.
Mahesh, I've seen you.
But
I love your style.
But she used to tell me, I love the way you dress.
Yeah.
I love the way you walk. I love the way you talk.
Yeah.
She loved everything about me.
Yes.
And started doing things. You know how you mentor without knowing that you are mentoring?
Yes.
We have mentored women.
Many young women look up to you. They watch you as you lead.
Yes.
And when I say you, I mean the leaders now ahead of us. Many young women here watch and they want to take up the podium. But then the environment is never conducive for mentorship. Why? Hamisa Zaja is there, wanting somebody to hold her hand at the top and pull. She's fighting her battles alone here. Why is it not conducive yet? And I know it's possible to be conducive. What is stopping us from bridging the gap of those who are there and the ones who now want to come in and lead?
Yeah, one reason. Some people that think just think that the way I see Rose, I don't think Rose will relate with me. So there is that general distance that is created in the mind.
Mm.
Or I created in my mind that I don't think I want to associate. So that's one of the reasons that I think brings that the gap, which should not even be there.
Mm.
We should make ourselves available to each other. So that if somebody has a reason to look for me, they will easily get to me. I don't put a wall or I don't put something or something to not allow that
to come in. Senator, what do you choose to challenge? You know, this International Women's Day, we are all choosing to challenge. Oh, by the way, before we go, all of you will talk. I said all of you, so we can leave tomorrow.
Yeah.
Okay, so Senator, what do you choose to challenge? On this International Women's Day, what do you personally choose to challenge?
In my view, the things that I think, one thing that we need to challenge or to face head on, in my view, is the fact that we think that there are some things that women can't do, and there are things that women can do. We need to challenge the barriers.
Stereotypes.
Yes, the barriers. Just the challenge barriers. Them. Yes.
But you know, Honorable, I need you to identify one barrier.
For me, the barrier that I need to is not allowing you. I mean, to me, what I don't believe in, I won't say I don't have money. I think the men are standing on my way. I don't want to bring those issues, but I want to deal with myself and say that the big barrier is about myself. I'm the one who puts myself down,
right,
and I think I can't do it.
Right.
So if we can work on that barrier,
yourself,
we should be yes, it has to be a self thing.
That's personal. Thank you. Powerful. Very powerful. Very powerful. I feel like dancing. Mali Bongwe. Mali Bongwe. Memory, please, I need you. Mali Bongwe. Mali Bongwe. Mali Bongwe. Mali Bongwe. Thank you. I love the powerful sentiments from the floor. You know, we have little time, but we will make it. Trust me. Julie Murimi wants to bring us some sense. She's hearing us yapping, yapping, and she's just laughing in her heart and saying, if you knew. Julie is going to talk to us, Juliet, about the role of election bodies in advancing gender equality in political leadership. Juliet comes from the compliance office of Registrar of Political Parties. You know women have wish lists. You know you wake up in the morning and you decide this is my wish list. I know sometimes our wish lists may not be commensurate with what the Registrar of Political Parties actually has. So please, welcome Juliet Murimi. This is good, this is important. Let's get the notes, let's hear her out, and in 10 minutes, Juliet is going to bring that to us. A big clap for Juliet.
I think there's sobriety still. You know, Mildred says that I'm bringing some sobriety. I think all that has happened here since morning is just sobriety. And so maybe just a small addition. You know, when you talk almost last, there are two things that might happen. One, you might not have prepared. And so you take points from each of the persons who've spoken before you, which I will exactly do. Because it always happens. Does it happen?
Yes.
Yes. The next thing that you do sometimes is that people who have spoken ahead of you have mentioned what you had. So sometimes you slightly repeat. I'll avoid to repeat because I know that we are in this course together. But I thank Mildred because of sanctioning that each of us must say something on which you stand to do. I think I choose to stand with women. I choose to stand with you to break the barrier of blackmail. Because I've seen blackmail in its real and in its full colors. Waithera can tell you, Waithera, before she activated her political genes, we were doing a lot of work with those politicians at the League of Kenya Women Voters. I think it's about 20 years ago. I was training at that time, what Daisy is now doing. We trained many women, Akina Rosa Buyu, Akina Rachel Shebesh. So I have that activism like Daisy's a bit before I became now a government officer. I had that particular experience. I also actually did a lot of political campaigns for women. Akina Honorable Chelaite, you remember? Yes. Akina the late Lona Laboso. And so we were in the field with Akina Waithera doing a lot of political activity. And Waithera did not tell you that women try and they fail. She did not get to being elected on the first shot. I can tell you that because she's my friend, and we've worked with her the way. Tumenunua unga, tumepeleka sana madhare, tumejaribu kukampaign uko, tukiva t-shirts, and I think it's part of the journey. And being part of the journey, I think every step of the way counts. I don't want to say so much, but I want to just appreciate the inspiration from Daisy. Daisy is very inspirational. She brings out that activism and she arouses action. And I think she just challenged because we need it. I want just to go very briefly without repeating so much what they've said. The topic that my boss, Andy Rito, who I must appreciate for nominating me here to attend, at least I have a day to interact and not really deal with the law as I always do every time, and just see women laugh. And I like being in the presence of women. So it's a good day for me. We were told to dissect the role of the election management body in advancing gender equality in political leadership in Kenya. The Office of the Registrar of Political Parties really is a partner in the electoral management, in the election management process, because we moved out of the IBC, which is actually the electoral body. So what I've done in my presentation, which is very brief and which is not very formal, it is still sober, but not very, very official, because today is a day for us to relax and think a bit about being happy, about being women, is the role of ORPP in advancing gender equality in political leadership. And our letter, I don't know whether your invitation letters read the same way as the one I got, was speaking about telling the journey so far, the joys, the tears, the milestones, and the future. I had a little difficulty fitting my presentation to this, but because I'm a compliance officer, I tried. And in very brief, the journey in this country, the journey for women participation and women inclusion and women attainment of political leadership and also leadership in decision making, as the SDG provides, as our lady from Uganda narrated, has been long, but it has not been negligible. I want to just give you a little history because I see for very good reason, and I'm very happy about that, that many people in this room are young. And even those who are not very young in terms of age are young minds. So, because they have been on the course. You know, there's a way you can make your mind remain young, and which women must do. Musizeke. I want to remind you of what our historical was just post-independence, the Mau Mau era. Women were very critical. And their traits, and I think Daisy should have included this one in the soul of the woman. Maybe it's a topic, I said, now, so I'll add on all of them. Women were the ones who were feeding the Mau Mau fighters. You know that? Yes, they were the ones who were actually going to the bush, cooking at home and hiding themselves undercover, going to the forest and waiting for the men. They come and feed them, and it's a long story short, but I don't know it, but I know that bit. And the quick bit about that particular issue is that women first, as our caregiver role is, which we must be proud of, I also do not like the new theme that women should stop thinking about their nurturing roles, because I support the placenta boldness, because those are also unique roles that we were given, and men cannot be able to do it. Have you ever been served at a catering where it's men who are doing outside catering, and they just look at you, songa, songa, songa? But women will serve you with a smile. Enjoy your food, and you know. So those Mau Mau ladies were very bold. I want us to take the boldness of those Mau Mau women. In your participation in political parties, do not take, because in political parties, our experience as an office is that women are very much relegated. We have women inclusion, and it's our role as a regulator to ensure that women participate. Post COK 2010, it is a requirement which we ensure that every political party must have women as members. I'll give you the numbers of how many women are in political parties, and it will shock you, because the numbers then do not, on a pro rata basis, reflect how women participate in politics. In terms of how you involve yourself within that political party, it is again a requirement. Hello, ladies. You need to be members of political parties. You should be members already. You have heard Waithera was in NAC Kenya. Mimi siku a member Waithera, but we did a lot of work for NAC Kenya those days. It's long. but she still moved to Jubilee. It does not matter what party you are in at the moment, but it is important for you, if you have that political vibe at all, to get into a political party. Because in that political party, you will start learning about being at the table of the decision making. It is a requirement by law that within those political parties, the governing body, which is normally called the National Executive Committee, I see Jane is here, I applaud you, she's a woman leader, she was a chair of the PPLC, currently she's the vice chair, again, let's applaud her. Genjiro. And you find that most of the times the women positions in those governing bodies are very defined. I have a list of what positions women hold in the governing bodies, I will just quickly read for you the members, the positions. We have very few women holding party leader positions. Do you know any? Yes. Which one do you know? Mother Karua? Charity Ngilu? Uh-huh. Any other? Julia Ojiambo? Uh-huh. No. Sorry. Another one? Okay. Homework, because you must now resuscitate political activity. We have four. We have four women who are party leaders, and as you can say from the room, you feel them. You actually feel them. Yeah? We have a few positions for secretary generals. We have about 13 secretary generals who are women. However, most treasurers, and this will shock you, this wale waweka hazina kwa chama, those political parties that you are not participating, can you imagine? 42 of them, and right now we have 72 political. I told my friend I met in the morning that I am one person who, because of that eagerness of breaking barriers, I want to be accessible. There's nothing. Just call me and say, just to confirm that I'm in the office. You come and we share, and we give you some of this political talk so that you can be able to position yourself. We have 43 political parties with treasurers. Why? Because women can be trusted with money. Women are not corrupt. Women are good money keepers. Women are keen. Women are... Can you imagine? And so my question is, if you're in a political party and you're the political, you're the governing body treasurer, why would you not be nominated by that political party for serving within your political party? And I think the call to action, because the title today is We Must Lead. Must is a firm word, and legally, must means there is nothing to negotiate about it. So that work that women, that time that women give, that energy that women give, that trust that women have gotten must count. And I think that's the action point that Daisy should add to the others, that women's contribution in the political parties must count, because you can feel it is a lot of contribution. The other positions, but the treasurer job is the one that is most pronounced, because there's the other one where each of the political parties have, which is supposed to be a woman representative. So that one is more of like our... The National Assembly one, where we have a woman rep. So that one, I won't count, but it also matters. I see her paper here. She's also, you're not a party leader, are you? Oh, she's one party leader. She was the Secretary General in a political party. She has moved to another political party recently. And because I have worked with them and I know them, she's now a party leader. So she's the fourth one you are looking for. Simum clapi etafadhali. Yeah, so with that small analysis, I just want to say that there have been joys working with politicians and specifically women political leaders, but there has been tears. When I was just doing my slides, the slide for tears got full. I ran over to slide two. It ran over to slide three. So I almost started crying. But all the same, there are enough joys because we need to celebrate our women. I want us to just feature what ways you can participate right now at your position so that you actually, because the political journey, maybe as Senator would tell you, you must build on it. It is not something that you wake up one day and you just say, oh, I felt like I dreamt that I can vie for an MCA. So you come and start looking for a political party and the election is 2 months away, and you must advance growth. You must think about it, you must be deliberate, and you must strategically position your idea if you want to be a leader. And all of us can be a leader. You can be a leader. You just need to identify your constituency. If you need to be realistic, if you have never taken any leadership position, even in church, you are never even a school prefect, start small. Because many mistakes that many women do is to meet this, maybe the other party leaders who are not women, and they are told, apana, wewe kuja, kuwa SG wa chama yangu, nitakupatia position, ama nitakupatia ticket, uvae for MP, and you are wasted. Because even your own village or even your own estate, people do not know you. So if your own village and your own estate, you are not known, how then would you vie for a national assembly? You fail, you know? You just become a non-starter. So on your own initiative, without seeking that other support, first become a member of a political party. By a show of hands, how many of you have voluntarily registered into political parties? Yes. So those other hands that are still lying, kindly join a political party, if at all this is a course that you want to pursue. Two, when you're in that political party, kindly get to know whether there's a position in the governing body. I'm telling you, impose yourself there. Leadership is not, even in church, you know, sometimes I hear people talking about the stereotypes that, politics is not church, but I'm in church myself, and even in church, we do elections. And I have a position in church. I am a secretary for 2 committees within my church, but I know it is also not given. So whoever says that even in church you are given a position, it is not given. So come to the political party head, neck, ask them, I would like to offer myself for this position. Take that position and run with it. When you are there, prove yourself. And that is the idea that you must really also show. If Waithera can tell you what she was doing for NAC Kenya, I will not expose her here because now she's the honorable. She used to do almost, you know, those things that really you would think are not very honorable, if I would say those words. Eh? And she used to do it and with very honestly. And even when we were going to Mathare, still, we were still able to do things that you really felt that, this must be done. And even if it is not the ultimate, you must be willing in your political parties to do those things. Why? Because they are stepping stones. Women, please identify what your stepping stones are. Finally, that is participation in the governing body. Finally, present yourself as candidates for election. One, present yourselves as candidates for election within your party. So many political parties do elections. They actually do because it's a requirement which we very sincerely follow through, that a political party must do their nominations, their elections, in order to place people into the governing body. If you do not offer yourself to that for that election, you will not be elected. You must present yourself as a candidate. In fact, you'll not be taken seriously in that political party. So appear as a candidate for that election. And also present yourself for the party primaries. Hello? Yes, party primaries. Women fear party primaries. We are working on developing an act. We have a draft bill. I think, Daisy, you're aware. The draft bill was published at Senate. We have amended that. I think Crown Trust also participated. And we have a memorandum amending the Senate bill because we want it to be a National Assembly bill because of the money component. And we want women to participate in party primaries because that is the only way you will make your party know that they should not give direct nominations. because they give direct nominations because there are very few candidates. So present yourself for candidature and seek. Even that gives you some experience. Eh? Ni lazima ulan, eh? And be ready to fall. Be ready to fall because as you may fall as many as 7 times, but on the 8th time, mi nasikianga hivyo sijui kama ni ukweli, ati huwezi anguka zaidi ya mara 7. So mara ya 8 utapata. But our God is gracious, and so you won't fall before. You will actually get it after falling maybe once. And for some whose grace is abounding, you will even get it the first time. So please try. Do not take a position of backseat. Usikae hapo na unasema, women must lead, na wewe hata hujajihusisha na party. Jihusishe. If you really do not are not ambitious about vying, you can be in that party and you can support a woman in your party. We have spoken about support here, isn't it? Yes. I am done with participation of parties. Naona nani anasimama. 2 minutes, but this is a bit... 2 minutes, I'll try. Yes. So we ensure that the parties have that gender. There's a graph I really wanted to share. There's a pie chart. The tiers, some of the tiers, which I said ran into 3 slides, there was the tiers during campaigns. During campaigns, there are insults. There's vulgar language addressed to women. And you must, for that, because even when you vie, it will still come. You must get thick skin. Hello? And the word is, you must, because you must lead. So the must still run through all the others. During elections, women are violated, assaulted, sometimes even sexually violated. What must you do? You must resist. And for those organizations, maybe like Femnet, you must also create an escape. You must give a safe house so that as you are ready, the way during elections or during every day. You are a member of a political party, you have been the SG, but because the patterns are changing, a woman is removed and given another job. And they are given deputy organizing secretary. Oh, it makes me feel like I want to cry. And I wonder, why would that woman not be then be given a chairperson position instead of a deputy organizing? Or deputy, I don't know, those things munasemanga jane. Deputy devolution, I don't know, deputy agriculture. I feel like it is wrong. You must protect your space. Let us fight against shortchanging. It's a lot of political betrayal where you actually find that even some political parties do not even propel who their candidates were. Then political party primaries period is the worst. That one, if you give me a day, I will speak about it and not tire. Daisy knows the passion I have for this bill. The nomination of candidates through party lists, you must, and that's why I say you need to be in the governing body so that you guard who are the names that are appearing on your party lists if they be. I know with the BBI, now that the BBI of KICC has attempted to work on the numbers and the nomination of party list after those who have participated in. We do not know. I can hear